could be in a spice bazaar halfway across the world. The heady scents of cumin and paprika, fresh mint and saffron. Welcome to the exotic, delicious world of Moroccan food, where eating is a total sensual experience. Join our food safari to learn the secrets of the perfect couscous. Simple recipes for preserved lemons and harissa, a spicy chicken and olive tagine, the best lamb for the barbie, and how to make the refreshing Moroccan mint tea.
Moroccan food, it's not just sitting and having a meal. It's a leisure thing that we can sit there and talk and have a laugh. Wow. It just gives that warmness and makes the afternoon, the lunch goes beautifully. Yeah.
Wow, so hospitality is the basis of everything you do.
Absolutely.
Casablanca-born restaurateur Omar Majdi grew up in his father's restaurant. Now owns Moroccan restaurant Tagine in Sydney and also enjoys cooking traditional meals at home. Omar, for my Moroccan pantry, what are essential ingredients?
The most traditional ingredient in Moroccan cooking, it's couscous. As in Morocco, we call it a gift from Allah. Because if you start with a handful like this, and by the time you finish with it, it will be fluffy, a beautiful couscous. It's a communal dish, it's a family dish. You get it all together, arm to arms, and you eat with your hand. And that's what couscous is all about. We use a lot of spices in Moroccan cuisines. For instance, saffron, which is like gold.
Oh, it's intense, it's beautiful.
If you put too much of it, it's overpowering. Mm. You just have to be very careful with this spice. Cinnamon, it's a very important.
And we know this as cassia bark, but you call this cinnamon.
Cinnamon. We use it as a bark, and we use it as ground as well. We buy it as a whole like this, and we just ground it as we go when we need it to keep it fresh, and it's got that power to it as well. We have cumin.
Ah.
Ground or seed, you marinate. If you have a chicken, if you have fish, if you have even dressing that you make as well in your salads. We use a lot of paprika, just sweet paprika, and this is to marinate lamb, fish, you name it. Orange blossom water, we use that to welcome guests and friends when they come to your home. We have these little bottles as people coming into your house. We just give them a little bit in their hand to wash their hands so they can get that fragrance on all the evening or the afternoon.
Beautiful.
And as well, we use it for cooking.
So sweet and savory.
Sweet and savory, absolutely. It's a part of the Moroccan culture.
Adding salt to lemons transforms them from an acidic fruit to a mellow lemony ingredient unique to Moroccan cooking, used for marinades and garnishes. Malika Anaim makes her own every couple of months.
Yeah, you just wash them with the water and just rub it like salt. So you just cut the lemon by four pieces. Keep the lemon whole. Salt.
What sort of salt?
Sea salt.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, light. So about 2 teaspoons?
Yeah.
How long do they need to sit in the jar?
4 weeks.
Four
3 weeks already,
yeah.
But it's more you leave it longer, more it's better.
Yeah, yeah. You squeeze it really hard.
Really hard, yeah. Have to squeeze it between, don't clip any room. Just squeeze one lemon on the top. Salt on the top, just like that. And you cover it with warm water. That's it. Finished.
But once you seal it, that's it
that's
for
it.
40 days, 40 nights?
Yeah. That's it, put it away.
Wow.
In the light, just in the cupboard, not in the fridge.
The The other essential is the chili paste called harissa, which is served with most meals.
You use fresh chilies to make
it? Yes, fresh chilies. Mm-hmm. Have to be very fresh and shiny like this. These little ones, it's very hot.
Malika adds chopped bird's eye chilies, preserved lemon, garlic, fresh coriander, ground cumin, salt, and olive oil. And adds a little bit more as it blends to a thick paste.
Is this going to be too much? Blow my mind. Mmm. Wow, that's fresh and zingy and hot. And hot!
A good tip is to add a layer of olive oil to preserve it. Across Morocco in the villages, women spend hours making the country's great staple, couscous, rubbing fine semolina with superfine semolina to coat it so it resembles a grain. The result when it's steamed is light and fluffy and adored across North Africa. When it's cooked traditionally, couscous is steamed three times, usually in a couscousia with meat or vegetables cooking below, the couscous absorbing the fragrant steam wafting up.
So you're not following the directions on the pack,
no,
on the instant pack?
No, definitely not. Uh-huh. That's sacrilegious to do that.
Sanaa Zaki simply doesn't have time to roll couscous, juggling three children and work as a university professor. So she's developed a cheats version using instant couscous. One of the favourite incarnations of couscous is with seven vegetables, which are cooked in the bottom part of a steamer in a rich stock. Sanaa adds swede and parsnips, carrot, zucchini and pumpkin.
And the skin stays on because that keeps its shape.
Tomatoes and frozen broad beans. Then the dry spices, coriander, ground ginger, cumin, paprika and a handful of fresh coriander and parsley.
So while we're waiting for that to start steaming up again, mm-hmm. I'll actually prepare the couscous ready for,
okay,
for steaming.
The secret, yep,
that's
Moroccan
it.
Way.
Yeah. And a little bit of vegetable oil, maybe two or three tablespoons. And then I just stir that through until the greens are coated in the oil. A teaspoon of salt for a packet of couscous. So I just keep adding water until it looks like it's reached saturation. So you can see that's soaked up, all the water. So put that on.
Uh-huh.
Once it starts steaming through, we can take the lid off. And you can see already it's starting to look very nice and fluffy. And I'll just turn it over. In Morocco, traditionally, they to make it light and fluffy, they'll use what's called smin. Uh-huh. And it's sort of like it's almost like a rancid butter. It's a very strong flavour, and it's really nice with couscous. Can't get it in Australia, so what I tend to use is some form of light blue bay, so some Castello or something.
Wow!
And that just adds a little kick to it as well. Makes it very nice.
God, the secrets!
And the idea is to do while it's still warm, so that it actually melts quickly. And you can smell the Castello coming through. It's really yummy. Yeah. There we go. So I just toss the water on. I just want to make sure I don't drown it. And again, put the lid on. Once it starts steaming through, we can take the lid off. That's looking good. Turn that onto our plate. Because we're all eating communal, we don't want all the pumpkin on one side and all the tomatoes on the other.
Amazing.
Very healthy, doesn't take too long to prepare, and as close to authentic as you can get.
We always have a salad before the main meal. And there's many salads, but the carrot and orange juice salad, that's probably the simplest, and for me, I think that's the best.
Sarah Anaim is studying for a business degree, but even before she started school, her first lessons were in the kitchen helping her mother and grandmother. Carrot salad is one of her specialties.
Okay. So, obviously, first you get your carrot and just chop them up. Colour is really important in Morocco. It really makes the table look good. Got the next step, which is the oranges. Just squeeze out all the juice. You expect the traditional, you know, with vinegar or sort of a bitter salad. This is quite different, very sweet.
So you use quite a lot of orange in that too.
Yep, it's usually with one carrot you'd use two oranges, so just double it. With the sugar, us Moroccans once again with the sweet. Got some rose water, not too much. Lastly, cinnamon. That you could put in about a teaspoon or something. Mix it all together.
Oh, yum.
Good?
Wow. And the most amazing combination of ingredients. That is fantastic. You can't cook Moroccan food without one of these, the tagine, the famous terracotta cooking pot with its conical lid. Chefs say anything cooked in a tagine tastes absolutely amazing.
It's just a magic dish, but I don't see it only as a look. I see it as a taste, a flavor. The aroma that you find in this dish here is absolutely worth investing in it. Every home should have at least one.
Chef Hassan Massouli has been cooking for over three decades, learning most of what he knows from his mother and applying the results to the three restaurants he's opened in Australia.
Can you cook with them on a barbecue?
In barbecue, great.
Yeah.
In charcoal, is great. Flame, lower heat, it's always great. Electric, I don't recommend it. You always have to be a distance between the fire and the tagine. Tagine need only the heat. That's why it takes time.
So not for the oven?
I want to see the oven, definitely not.
And if you've got something that would sit straight on a heat source, is there something that you do to protect the food?
The best thing I find is celery, to leave that gap, like a line in between. And when you put your chicken or meat, it doesn't allow the chicken to burn.
Do you need to do anything before you start cooking with it?